Thank you all for coming. Welcome to Lambda Jam. My name is Stuart Sierra. I work at Relevance. I do a lot of work with Clojure. And I first did this talk at the first Lambda Jam in Brisbane, Australia. And I chose these three words that tend to come up a lot when we're talking about Clojure or functional programming in general. I don't actually know what they mean, and I'm not going to try to define them because I think it's kind of cheating to put a bunch of dictionary definitions on your slides. Except that's my first slide. So this is a word that gets thrown a lot thrown around a lot in context of functional programming, particularly in Clojure, and that's the idea of a value, some immutable quantity or a data structure. All of Clojure's data structures are immutable values, and this is Rich Hickey's definition of value. So I think of data as values that you can see. It's kind of a fuzzy definition. It's not very precise, so don't quote me on that, especially not in front of Rich. But when I started working on this talk, I started thinking about how I learned programming and how that kind of led me to functional programming. So I went all the way back to my very first computer, which was one of those. That is a Timex Sinclair 1000, which I found in an attic when I was about 7. And it's a good thing I wasn't any older than that, because if I had been, I wouldn't have been able to type on that little membrane keyboard. My fingers would have been too big. But this was a computer. You could plug it into a television set and program it in BASIC. And so I started playing around with this. You know, I didn't really know what I was doing. I was reading the manuals, making little loops that print things over and over again on the screen. But I think really, you know, BASIC is a very good language for starting to learn about programming because it's very visible. It's very easy to see what the program is doing. There's not a lot of abstraction. There's not a lot of data, in fact, but it's an interactive system that you can just sort of follow along with and understand what the program is doing. A few years later, I got my first real computer. It was a 386 running MS-DOS 5, which had this delightful little program along with it called QBASIC. Yeah. QBASIC was, I think it was a great little programming environment. It was quite sophisticated for its time, actually. It was an IDE with an integrated editor, debugger, interactive console, and a language runtime. So it was a complete interactive development system. So I actually learned how to write some simple programs in QBASIC. Again, I didn't do a whole lot with it. I was still a kid. But there was one interesting feature of QBASIC that stuck with me, and I often go back to it because I've never seen a contemporary programming language that actually makes this distinction the same way that QBASIC did. QBASIC distinguished between subroutines and functions. A subroutine was some piece of code you could call and it would do something, but it didn't return any value. It just ran to completion and then went back to wherever you called it from. A function could return a value, and you actually wrote that by setting the name of the function equal to the value you wanted to return. So it was really sort of emphasizing the idea that the value of a function is what it returns. QBASIC also distinguished between statements and expressions. And a subroutine could only appear in a statement position, and a function could only appear in an expression position. Now, of course, when I was a kid, I thought subroutines were clearly where it was at, because that was where you made things happen. You could draw stuff on the screen, you could print stuff out. That was the fun stuff. But I'd been introduced to this notion very early on that there was a difference between action and computation, between behavior and values. So I was starting to think by this point that I might want to be a professional programmer when I grew up. And I knew that real professional programmers wrote their programs in C++. So I decided that clearly I had to learn C++, and I bought one of those books, Teach Yourself C++ in 21 Days. If anyone's seen this cartoon, it's probably a little small to read, but this basically explains that the only way to teach yourself C++ in 21 days is to spend a lifetime learning C++ and then invent a time machine to go back in time to day 21 and replace your former self. So C++ was an interesting language. I encountered a whole bunch of new concepts that I had never seen before. And it was clear that it was a very powerful language. There are lots of very powerful abstractions in C++, but they're mostly about mechanical things. They're mostly about dealing with the computer. Things like memory management, virtual dispatch, constructors, destructors, inheritance, all these things are sort of about the mechanics of the program, and you can do very sophisticated things with them. But as someone who was still learning programming, it was a bit too many new concepts at once, and they were all distracting me from what I actually wanted to do. I wanted to write a program that did something. So the abstractions in C++ were not about the data in the program. They were about how the program works. The other problem I ran into with C++ is that it didn't give me a lot of visibility into what the program was doing. I couldn't see how it worked. I would try to run my program and it would seg fault. Well, now what do I do? Who knows? You know, if I'd known about debuggers and stack traces and all sorts of other extra skills, I might have been able to rerun the program from the beginning and figure out where it went wrong. But just from this output, there's nothing I can do. It's a complete black box. So suffice to say, I never got very good at C++. A few years later, one of my neighborhood geeks came by and gave me a CD with Red Hat Linux 6. And I discovered the QBasic of Linux, known as Perl. Perl was a great little language. I loved Perl. I mean, first of all, it was all just right there. Everything I needed to do Perl programming was there. I didn't have to go online and download any extra libraries or things. I didn't have to read a book that would teach me something in 21 days. It was all right there. This was still before Google and before Stack Overflow, so if you wanted to program something, you actually had to learn about it. And it was very easy to do. You could actually learn Perl just by reading the man pages and kind of going through all the tutorials that it came with. So Perl was fun. It provided a bunch of new abstractions that actually made my life easier. They made certain mechanical aspects of the program invisible. Memory management completely disappeared. I didn't have to think about it anymore. So garbage collection was a huge abstraction that provided a tremendous amount of benefit to me as a programmer, learning still. The other idea that Perl introduced me to for the first time was this notion of having just a few generic data structures that could represent pretty much everything in my program. In C++, all of the tutorials and examples spent a lot of time creating new data structures. I almost never did that in Perl. Perl had all the data structures that I really needed. Lists, actually they were called arrays in Perl, and maps, which Perl called hashes, and then scalars, which were strings or numbers. And these were not values in the functional programming sense. They were mutable data structures, but still, they were pretty much all you needed to represent any kind of data. If you had a sequential data structure, a map data structure, and some scalar data structure, you could manage pretty much any kind of representation that you needed. So this was another very powerful abstraction for me because it allowed me to just write the program that I wanted and know that it would be usable with a bunch of different libraries. There were a whole bunch of built-in functions in Perl, and then all the libraries on CPAN, all dealing with these fundamental data structures, and I knew that they would all interoperate. The other really interesting feature Perl had, and it had kind of a strange way of implementing it, but it had abstract data types that could have different implementations. In Perl, they were called tied data structures. So you could tie some representation of data, an array or a hash, to some different implementation, to some different backing store. And this was another really powerful abstraction because it makes entire areas of your program disappear by making them look like something else. So I could get an array that was tied to lines of text in a file. And so then all of the tools and functions that I have for manipulating arrays, I can also apply to manipulating lines of text in a file. Or I could have a Perl hash that was tied to a database record, and anything I do to that hash would be applied to the database record. This was a very powerful tool, and it took me quite a few years to get back to a language that had some similar capability. So by this time, I was probably in my early teens, and I was thinking I definitely wanted to be a professional programmer when I grew up. And so this was the 90s, and that meant if I wanted to be a professional programmer, I had to learn XML. That was the hot new thing. Everybody was doing it. If you weren't learning XML, you weren't going to be a real programmer. The problem was it wasn't immediately obvious what you do with XML. It wasn't really a programming language, at least not then. It was just a data structure, you know, with these tags and attributes and values and things, which was interesting. But if you wanted to write a program in XML, you could basically do one of two things. One, you could write programs in another language that manipulated XML. So I tried doing that for a while. I wrote little Perl programs that would manipulate some XML data that I'd written in another file. And I didn't know it at the time, but this was the very beginning of thinking in a lispy kind of way. I was writing my program in one abstract language in some XML vocabulary that I'd invented, and then writing the code to interpret that vocabulary to do what I wanted. But, you know, this didn't really feel like XML. I didn't feel like I was actually really embracing the power of XML that everyone was talking about. To do that, you had to use XSLT. And XSLT was another interesting language. I actually really liked it. It was a little bit strange, but it introduced me to a lot of concepts that in retrospect, look a lot like functional programming concepts. XSLT had variables that you could only assign once, so they were kind of like immutable data. It had pattern matching. It had recursion. So a lot of the, I wouldn't go so far as to call XSLT a functional programming language, but it definitely had a lot in common. And this is where I was first introduced to some of these concepts. XSLT was also my first homoiconic programming language. It's written in XML and it manipulates XML as data. In theory, I suppose I could have written XSLT programs that manipulated other XSLT programs, but I didn't go that far. That would have been a bit much. But the other idea that really struck me when I was learning about XSLT is that you could represent an entire program as a series of data transformations. And I actually did this. I discovered that if you were writing a program to generate a bunch of XML documents, like, oh, a website, you could do it in XSLT. And so I would write these little programs in XSLT that would generate static web pages using a series of transformations. I would start with one XML file that kind of defined the content of the site I was building, and then I'd run it through a series of transformations with these XSLT templates. Of course, I had to write a shell script to do that. But the nice thing about this is that, again, I had visibility into what these programs did. I could take them one step at a time, and if something went wrong somewhere along the chain, I could trace it back. I could look at each of those intermediate files and see what the output was, see what it was doing. So again, I was starting to think in a slightly lispy way. I didn't know it at the time, of course, but I was writing my program as a series of data transformations, just operating as pure functions from one data structure to the next. So finally, I went to school and started learning some real programming, which meant I learned Java. And, you know, Java wasn't bad. I had, you know, I still had garbage collection. I still had some useful features. But I noticed something that just really irked me a lot about Java, or really a lot of these, you know, C++ has a similar thing, but I really encountered this most in Java. Is that I had these generic data structures. I had lists and maps and sets in Java. But I couldn't really use them as much as I was used to, because any other piece of code or any example I was looking at would define a whole bunch of new types specific to the problem it was dealing with. So I ended up writing a lot of sort of mechanical code to transform one type into a more generic type, without actually really changing anything about the data. And this grew to bother me a lot. It meant that I was writing a lot of extra code just to get some visibility into what the data was. I couldn't see my data when it was wrapped up in these objects. So somewhere along the line, I read all those articles on Slashdot or whatever it was about Lisp, and how Lisp was the greatest programming language ever. And so I picked up this great little book by Peter Seibel called Practical Common Lisp. And I really liked Lisp. I had a lot of fun with Lisp. I was learning about algorithms at the time, and I discovered that I could write very generic functions in Common Lisp that would implement algorithms in a very, very expressive way. This simple example I wrote just as an exercise was a breadth-first search. But I could do breadth-first search on anything. Anything that had a successor function, I could perform a breadth-first search of it. And that was a really powerful idea. Now, I had all the usual frustrations with Common Lisp. Files were weird. Doing stuff with the operating system was weird. There were all the different implementations. But I still had a lot of fun with it. But there were a few things that I really couldn't do easily in Common Lisp. And one of those things was the thing that I'd gotten used to all the way back with Perl. It was those generic data structures that could be tied to different implementations. Common Lisp had a great library of data structures. They were very powerful, but all of the built-in functions were defined exclusively to work on those built-in structures. They couldn't be extended to anything else. So I could use functions like mapcar and mapcat to iterate over a list, but I couldn't use it to iterate over another collection. There also weren't those same nice literal representations of those data structures that I had in Perl. You know, Common Lisp had hash tables, but they had a completely different syntax from the built-in list data structure. Now, of course, I could have extended Common Lisp. It was a very flexible language. I could have added these capabilities myself. But I think because they weren't built into the language, they weren't universal enough to be used by lots of other libraries. And this made it difficult to compose different libraries written in Common Lisp. They might all define their own new abstractions, and because they could only meet on these concrete data structures, it was harder to combine them together. So by this point, I had done some programming, and I had my two favorite languages. I had Perl, where everything was sort of strings, and you could do whatever you want, and I had Lisp, which was very algorithmic and very pure. Obviously, the thing to do was combine them. So I did. I decided to embed Perl 5 in Common Lisp using a foreign function interface. And I decided this was so important to the open source community that I had to write it as a literate program. And I did actually get this to work. There were a lot of strange things I had to do. In particular, I learned that most of the Perl 5 internals were actually implemented as C preprocessor macros. And I had to recreate those somehow using the foreign function interface in Common Lisp. But I did get it to work. I got it to the point where you could call Perl functions from Lisp and pass Perl data structures around and mix them with Lisp data structures. And it worked. Unfortunately, the idea was so abhorrent to Common Lisp programmers that they ran me out of town on a rail. So I gave up on Perl and Lisp. I don't think anyone ever used it. But by this point, I actually had a real job. I was writing computer programs for a living, which of course meant I was actually building websites for a living. And so I got into Ruby on Rails. This was the hot new thing that you had to be doing if you were doing web programming. And I really liked Ruby. Ruby had a lot of features that I liked. It had sort of this mix of lispiness and Perliness that felt really natural right away. It had a lot of the features I liked from Perl, like the built-in data structures, but it also had functions, lambdas, things that I'd gotten used to from Common Lisp. But after working with Ruby for a while and using some of these frameworks, this was, I was using Rails back around version 1.2, back when it made sense. That's not nice. I really liked this stuff. You know, I really got a lot of use out of it. But I started noticing this pattern that a lot of Ruby libraries wanted to extend the language in some way for whatever task they were doing, whether it was web development or testing or XML parsing or validation or anything else. Because the language was so flexible, because you could sort of reach in and muck with objects and mess around with the interpreter, you could do all this crazy stuff to make your programs very expressive and very concise. You would end up with things like this. This was actually a library that I really liked and really used quite a lot. It was an XML processing library called hprecot. And hprecot could parse an XML file and then give you back this object. It was kind of hard to figure out what the type of that object was, but it was some object, and you could call methods on it to search through the XML tree. So one example was you could use the division operator to search through the tags in an XML document. And this lets you write some very nice terse expressions like this to kind of drill down into a document. And there's nothing syntactically wrong with this. Division is just an ordinary method in Ruby, so we're just calling a method that happens to be named with a slash. But, you know, it felt a little bit weird. And as you add more of these things on top of each other, they get more and more confusing. If one library is co-opting the division operator for one type of operation, and another library is co-opting, the array access brackets to do something else clever, all of a sudden you're not really writing Ruby anymore. You're writing this sort of mishmash of languages that look like Ruby but are actually something else. It was like every one of these libraries defined its own pidgin language for doing some specific task. It wasn't quite a language in its own right, and it had semantics that were similar to Ruby, but not quite the same. Now, you can do this in any language, of course. People actually did it a lot in Common Lisp with macros. Any language that lets you sort of hack the compiler or the interpreter and change the meaning of things allows you to do things like this. And sometimes they're necessary. Sometimes you do actually need to do these things. But I find that they often end up being more trouble than they're worth. So then, around 2007, I was a member of a local users group called Lisp NYC. And I saw a talk there by a guy with long hair named Rich Hickey, who had this language he was working on called Clojure. And I was immediately drawn to Clojure. It really struck a chord with me. I started using it almost right away. It had all the features I'd been missing from Common Lisp that I liked in other languages. It had those universal data structures again. I could write literal data structures into my program, like lists and maps and sets. And it also had immutable data structures. I didn't realize the benefit of that for a long while, but it turned out to be a very useful thing. And these data structures were generic. They were they could have different backing implementations. They weren't tied to one specific implementation. And you could do very clever things with them. One of the interesting things that Clojure came with early on, which somewhat to my disappointment hasn't really been developed fully since then, is an inspector. This was a little piece of code that would pop up a widget that would let you explore a data structure, like a tree or a list, using a GUI widget rather than trying to just print it all out. This is still in Clojure, by the way. It doesn't get used a whole lot. I don't think it's been updated recently, but it's a really neat idea that you can make a data structure visible in some form other than just its printed literal form. But the nicest thing about Clojure's data structures is that they were all built on a few simple abstractions, like sequences. So all of the functions that I'd gotten used to in Common Lisp, all of those list manipulating functions, were now generalized to work on almost anything. So I could use map, which was mapcar in Common Lisp, and I could map over anything. Not just a data structure, but files or lines or XML tags or any other thing that could be represented as a sequence. So again, this was a very powerful abstraction, the same way Perl's tied data structures were. They allowed me to extend the vocabulary I already had, things I already knew how to do, to operate on new types of data. It was even very easy to write new pieces of data, new data structures that adhered to this same contract, that followed the same abstraction. So in Clojure, you can generate lazy sequences by providing a function that generates each new value of the sequence. This means that it's very easy to extend those built-in abstractions to new types, the thing that I found difficult to do in other languages. And it meant that creating new abstractions, actually defining new syntax and grammar or new little pidgin languages using macros, was far less important. I found I didn't need to do that very often. And now, in fact, I'm frequently suspicious of libraries that use a lot of macros to create their abstractions, because that means I can't see them. I can't manipulate them with the tools that I already have. I'm limited to whatever tools the author of that library has written. So just as another example of this, this is kind of an aside, but Clojure's maps can look up a value by its key. And in the Datomic database, which also can use maps to represent data, it can use those to represent bidirectional relationships without adding any new sort of semantics to the program. It just says, okay, put an underscore at the front of the name of a key, and that means I'll look for the reverse relationship to that piece of data. But I noticed, after I'd been writing Clojure programs for a while, that I'd started to get into some habits that made my programming more difficult. I started to write code something like this. It would, it would get some input and then do some calculation on it and then eventually produce some side effect as a result. So I could run this code interactively. I still had a REPL, but I wouldn't get any value or data back. I couldn't see what this program did unless I looked for a missile or an empty hard drive somewhere. So I realized eventually that what I was doing was writing subroutines, not functions. I was writing code that was just doing a series of steps, performing a series of actions. And sometimes that's what a program needs to do. But as the programs got more complex, it became harder and harder to visualize what they were doing, harder to get visibility into how the program worked. So I started adapting the way I wrote programs. I started trying to do things that made my programs more transparent, more visible. And it ended up looking often something like this. I would write my program to take some state of the world as its input and then add to that state of the world, not replace it, not immediately carry out some side effect, but just add to the store of information that I had. So I might do some computation and add that to my store of knowledge and then do a conditional check and take the result of that and add it to my store of knowledge. And this gives me a nice little program that I can experiment with. I can test it, I can play with it in the REPL with different inputs. So this kind of program obviously doesn't do anything by itself, but then it's very easy to add a very simple piece of code at the end, one little subroutine that's going to take the output of my program, take the data, and then carry out some side effects based on it. So this is how I started trying to write my programs, as a series of data transformations with just one set of side effects at the very end. Now this has a bunch of nice properties. One, these programs tend to be easier to compose together. You can insert new steps into the middle. You could add additional visibility helpers like logging. And I realized that pretty much every program that I wrote could be represented this way. I could think of any program generally as just a series of data transformations, functions taking an immutable value as input and returning an immutable value as output. And then right at the very edges, I had to do some conversions. So I would try to write programs that took some input from the outside world, whether that was a file or a web request or something coming in over the network, and as quickly as possible, transform that into closures data structures, get it into data as quickly as I could with as little extra work or conversion as I could do. Then represent the program as a series of data transformations. Just take it step by step, adding and removing bits of information until eventually I arrived at some piece of data that I could easily transform into the output or side effect or whatever I needed the program to do. And I realized I could actually represent almost any program this way. Although, of course, in reality, lots of programs have multiple inputs and multiple outputs. So it ends up looking less like this nice, clean, linear pathway and more like a tree of different pathways, where maybe some side-affecting operation or subroutine also produces some more input, and you feed that into the next stage of the program. But even so, the more of the program that fits into these nice, pure data operations, the easier it is to test and debug, and the easier it was to write. So when I was working at Relevance, and I still am working at Relevance, we were writing web apps in Clojure. And we noticed that a lot of web apps have a pattern that fits into this very well. You're going to receive an HTTP request as your input and eventually produce an HTTP response as your output. So it fits very neatly into this pattern. And we noticed that usually there are a series of functions that have to get run. There are several stages in this pipeline of producing the response to this request. And usually each of those stages is going to do something to the request as it comes in, and then do something to the response as it comes out. Now, one way to represent that is to create a bunch of nested functions where each one calls the next, sort of wrap all the functions inside each other so that each one gets a chance to do something at the beginning of the processing and at the end of the processing. But we noticed there was a problem with that, which was that if we ever wanted to respond on a different thread from the one that we started on, if we wanted to break that chain somewhere and then go somewhere else, we couldn't do it because everything was happening in one call stack. So we decided, okay, let's take these functions and split them apart. Let's take each of these functions in our chain of web processing functions and split it into two pieces. One piece, an enter function that operates on the request as it comes in, and then another piece, a leave function that operates on the response as it's going out. And then we'll write a little interpreter program that calls these functions in the right order and keeps track of where we are in the chain. This means that we can actually pause the execution of this chain of functions anywhere we want to dispatch somewhere else. We could go to another thread, we could pause for a while and not respond until we get some data from somewhere else. But we can still preserve these sort of pairs of functions that we need. A simple example of this would be reading a cookie on the way in and then setting a cookie on the way out. Those two functions are linked together. They sort of need to happen at the same point in the processing, but one happens to the request and one happens to the response. So this was a framework that we developed called Pedestal. We're still working on it. It's kind of a work in progress, but it uses this idea for handling HTTP requests. And the other half of Pedestal attempts to do something similar with front-end JavaScript applications, to represent them entirely as data. Now, I'm not going to talk a lot about this because we've got whole workshops on web development this afternoon. But the basic idea with Pedestal applications is that they represent the entire state of the application as a data structure and all of the changes to the application as data structures. Every new change that happens in the user interface of a Pedestal program is some piece of data, and you can look at it. You can see it in a log. You can manipulate it however you want. And this has a bunch of interesting properties, including the fact that most of the UI code in Pedestal doesn't actually touch the browser. It doesn't have to deal with the DOM, which means you can run it in Clojure on the JVM. You can use all of the great testing frameworks that Clojure has to develop and test your UI code, and then add just enough code, just enough subroutines at the end to actually manipulate the DOM and draw stuff on the screen. This idea that your program is manipulating data and that everything else is sort of kept separate from that has shown up in other places, in particular this thing called hexagonal architecture, also sometimes called ports and adapters. And the shape, the actual shape of the hexagon is not important. The idea with this is that rather than thinking of your program as a series of layers, where each layer depends on the thing below it, you think of your application as being this core thing in the middle that's just manipulating data, and it's connected to a bunch of different external services that may involve state and side effects. So those could be testing, GUIs, databases, websites, whatever. So if you think of your program as just being a collection of pure functions manipulating data structures, you end up with something very similar. You have your core program, which is just manipulating data structures. That's very easy to develop, easy to test, very easy to reason about. And then around the edges of it, and as far out as you can put them, you put the adapters, the things that connect it to the outside world, whether that's a database or a GUI or anything else. So, of course, these abstractions are useful. They're sort of aspirational goals. I don't always get my programs to be as purely functional as I would like them to be. It's always something I'm working towards and trying to figure out. Of course, Dijkstra thought of all of this decades before I was born. And I try to pursue abstractions that make programs more visible, that make it more apparent, that make it easier to see what the program is doing. There are very rare exceptions to that. There are the abstractions that actually make entire areas of the program invisible, things like garbage collection. Those are very powerful tools, but they're also very rare, and you don't need that many of them to get good utility. And obviously, you can't make something completely invisible. Garbage collection makes memory management invisible right up until the point where it doesn't. But you can make it invisible for the vast majority of your uses of it. So that's all I have time for. I'll be hanging around here, happy to answer questions later on, and I've got closure stickers and stuff if you want one of those. Thank you all for coming.